وبروفيسور عاصم هو عميد كلية إدارة الأعمال، وعندنا الدكتورة أسماء رئيسة قسم المحاسبة والتمويل، وفي الوسط صورة الإعلامية ميس عنبر. أنا ما أعرف منو من بعد هاي الصورة اللي طالعة. فأهلا وسهلا بك معالي ميرزا الصاير، وهذا الشرف أنه أنت تمثل سمو الشيخ بالكلمة الأولى إن شاء الله في هذا المؤتمر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
Can we give the floor to Ms. Mays Anwar? She is our MC for the conference. بعد إذن البروفيسور مثنى إذا يسمح لي بالمقاطعة. The floor is yours, Ms. Mays.
We are Thank under... you very much. Thank you, Prof. Marwan. Tislam.
The floor is yours.
بداية السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. His Excellency Mirza Sayegh, Director of the Office of His Highness Sheikh Hamdan bin Rashid Al Maktoum, Member of Trustees at the American University in the Emirates, Chairman and Members of AUE of Board of Trustees, President and all members of AUE, respected researchers, all participating in the third International Conference of Scientific Research. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good morning, everyone. It's an honor and a privilege to welcome you all to the third International Conference for the Scientific Research held virtually by the American University in the Emirates AUE under the theme Transition to Knowledge Economy, Challenges, Smart Opportunities and Innovation. And under the patronage of His Highness Sheikh Hamdan bin Rashid Al Maktoum, Deputy Ruler of Dubai, Minister of Finance. Allow me to begin by welcoming their excellencies, the chairman and members of the AUE Board of Trustees, the researchers attending this conference from around the world, and the esteemed audience who have joined us today. On this occasion, I would like to thank, first of course, I would like to thank the AUE academic and administrative community, as well as the members of a steering committee responsible for overseeing the execution of this distinguished conference under the leadership of the President, Prof. Muthanna Abdul Razzaq, for their exceptional efforts in shaping the conference to be a progressive platform in the field of applied sciences aimed at the difficult circumstances around the world. This conference aims to encourage scholars, researchers, and staff in applied sciences, urging them to effectively contribute to the scientific dialogue fostered by the great vision of the wise leadership of the beloved country, our beloved country. That sharp vision toward education and scientific research acts as a spark to the future, reflecting on how to heavily invest in the education sector and support knowledge economy. The circumstances under which this conference is held are no less than unusual, with the global events unfolding in a way that have been transformative. And yet, in spite of the several challenges, the university wanted to transform those into opportunities, a spirit that has brought this conference to you. And as far as I know, this is the first conference to virtually take a place in the Arab region. As the AUE strongly confirms with the vision of His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, Vice President of the State, Prime Minister, Ruler of Dubai, God protect him, and his saying, nothing is impossible, ma shay mustahil, with a firm belief that his vision lead to success, affirming as a fundamental principle to follow at both theoretical and practical level. The conference organizers have realized the challenges that we are witnessing at this time and have therefore focused with its main theme and topics at the COVID-19 pandemic. And participating researchers were requested to dedicate their research to examine the potential influence and effects of COVID-19, action needed to fight it and promote the exchange of scientific dialogue, and that will certainly be rich, inspiring, and meaningful, inshallah. We are all confident that the distinguished researchers present us today from several countries across the world will be driving powerful contribution that will enrich the search for solution to face and contain the virus and will have significant suggestion at local, regional, and international level. We hope that this conference in its exceptional version will continue to act as a platform promoting dialogue, cooperation, and communication between individuals and organizations who have prioritized and shown active commitment toward the pandemic scientific accountability with all its effect. A commitment that aims to encourage better pandemic planning to face future challenges, as participating research papers drive a practical rather than theoretical recommendation and conclusion that are applicable in nature, benefiting both public and private sectors. Once again, I would like to welcome all of you, and I wish you all participants of this conference that will find it enriching and meaningful. أرحب بكم جميعا بالمؤتمر وإن شاء الله يا رب يكون المؤتمر إلى عائد على الصعيد النظري وعلى الصعيد أيضا التطبيقي. بداية أدعو سعادة الأستاذ ميرزا الصايغ, His Excellency ميرزا الصايغ, Board Member at the AUE Board of Trustees and Director of His Highness Sheikh Hamdan bin Rashid Al Maktoum to address us with his speech. المنصة إلك أستاذ ميرزا الصايغ.
شكرا دكتورة عنبر. أولا أشكر أخي وزميلي وأستاذي معالي اللواء أحمد الرئيسي على هذه الفرصة الثمينة اللي جمعتنا معاكم جميعا, وطبعا الشكر إلى أخي وعزيزي الأستاذ الدكتور مثنى على إعداد هذا البرنامج الجميل اللي يضم نخبة من الأساتذة والأصدقاء في أنحاء العالم, ويعني نتمنى أن تتاح لنا الفرصة للقاء وجها لوجه, يعني خاصة مع الدكتور توفيق والأخت ميس والبروفيسور مروان, كلكم إن شاء الله تنتهي هذه الجائحة ونبدأ العمل من جديد يدا بيد. It's an honor to talk to you all on behalf of His Highness Sheikh Hamdan bin Rashid Al Maktoum, Deputy Ruler of Dubai and Minister of Finance, to inaugurate the third AUE International Research Conference under the theme Transition to Knowledge Economy Challenges, Smart Opportunities and Innovation. As the first research conference to be conducted virtually in the Middle East, covering vital sectors of the economy and the impact of COVID-19, it gives me great pride to welcome the esteemed guests, researchers, practitioners, and participants. I would also like to extend my gratitude to the Board of Trustees of the American University in the Emirates, its leadership, its chairman, who saw the challenges of the present pandemic and transformed them into an opportunity to continue advancing its mission in line with the vision of our nation's leaders, who believe that with determination, nothing is impossible. It's my hope that the research presented today will be translated into real solutions, actions, and initiatives that will not only advance scientific inquiry, but also create positive change and lasting impact in our society and neighborhood alone. I would like to thank the members of the steering committee chaired by Professor Muthanna Abdulrazak, President and CEO of the American University in the Emirates, in taking such a challenge of organizing an intellectual-rich conference during COVID-19 and successfully collaborating with researchers from around the world with the belief that crisis at the moment facing us drives opportunities which leads to accelerated innovation. This conference warrants that digital transformation led to the continuity of exchange of knowledge. And I wish you all the best as you engage in what I am certain will be engaging in enriching discussion on the pressing issues of our times. Talking about research, from this rostrum, I would like to really to invite nations, as we did in the Emirates, under our energetic and young Minister of Tolerance, Sheikh Anhayan bin Mubarak Anhayan, who initiated research activities. I would like really to invite everybody to allocate part of their revenues at the rate of less than 1% for the research activities. We should really encourage the donors, such as charity organizations, such as civil organizations and government departments, to allocate this kind of percentage for the research purposes. At the moment, UAE is not really empty of researchers. We have a plenty of practitioners, plenty of doctors, and plenty of scientists. We reached actually the nuclear energy for solution for peaceful use. 2 weeks ago, we sent our probe Hope to Mars. I think UAE, under its leadership, energetic ministers, lovely, lovable, really, president and prime minister, the crown prince of Abu Dhabi, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed, are all supporters of these initiatives. They are only waiting for you to come up with suggestions. We cannot really reach Mars without your support. We are all capable of doing that. UAE can lead this kind of operations. We have allocated resources to go to Mars. The late His Highness Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, our beloved late president, has laid the foundation stone in the early 70s. And his dream came true 2 weeks ago. We cannot stand alone in this problem without the cooperation of everybody. The world is one village. With all of you, researchers, practitioners, innovations, we will reach the skies, and the skies are the limit. I wish you all success and progress in your endeavors and your deliberations under the wise leadership of Dr. Ahmed Al-Raisi and Dr. Muthanna. I'm sure that your conclusions will be the ones we are all looking for. Regards again from His Highness Sheikh Hamdan Al-Rashid Al-Maktoum, who called this morning to say, wish you good luck. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
شكراً لك, His Excellency Mirza Sayegh. شكراً لك أستاذ Mirza. الآن أود أن أدعو الميجر جنرال دكتور أحمد ناصر الرئيسي. Major General Dr. Ahmed Nasser Raisi, General Inspector of the Ministry of Interior, Chairman of Board of Trustees at the American University in the Emirates, AUE. I would love to invite you to address us with your speech.
Thank you, Maisa. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I will speak in Arabic for sure. So, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. وصبحكم الله بالخير والسرور في هذا اليوم الجميل حقيقة بوجودكم جميعا. بداية تقدم بجزيل الشكر والامتنان لسمو الشيخ حمدان بن راشد المكتوم نائب رئيس أو نائب حاكم دبي وزير المالية رعاه الله على رعايته الكريمة لمؤتمر العلمي الدولي الثالث تحت شعار الانتقال إلى اقتصاد المعرفة التحديات والفرص الذكية. وعلى كلمتي التي ألقاها نيابة عن سعادة الأخ العزيز الأستاذ ميرزا الصايغ والتي تدل بشكل قاطع على الدعم الدائم التي توليه القيادة الرشيدة في دولة الإمارات العربية المتحدة للبحث العلمي التطبيقي وذلك سعياً لتحقيق كافة الأهداف التي تضعها حكومة دولة الإمارات العربية المتحدة وعلى رأسها صاحب السمو الشيخ خليفة بن زايد آل نهيان رئيس الدولة حفظه الله وأخي صاحب السمو الشيخ محمد بن راشد المكتوم نائب رئيس الدولة رئيس مجلس الوزراء حاكم دبي رعاه الله وصاحب السمو الشيخ محمد بن زايد آل نهيان ولي عهد أبو ظبي نائب القائد الأعلى للقوات المسلحة في كافة القطاعات الاقتصادية والاجتماعية والعلمية وغيرها من القطاعات الأخرى خصوصا في ظل جائحة كورونا والتي تعتبر تحدي جديد أمام كافة دول العالم لقد أثبتت فيها دولة الإمارات العربية المتحدة إنه لا شيء مستحيل وأثبتت كذلك إن هذه الدولة الفتية قادرة على تجاوز كافة التحديات التي تواجهها من خلال الأسس القوية والمتينة التي أسسها باني هذه النهضة المغفور له بإذن الله الوالد الشيخ زايد بن سلطان آل نهيان والتي تستند بالأساس لتعزيز جودة الحياة للمجتمع الإماراتي وبناء وطن آمن مستقر ينعم فيه قاطنيه بالخير والرفاه والسعادة والإيجابية ودولتنا على العهد تمضي في سبيل إسعاد المجتمع والارتقاء بالكوادر الوطنية قدما نحو مزيد من الإنجازات وتطويع المستحيل ومن هذا المنطلق جاء هدف انعقاد هذا المؤتمر العلمي عن بعد كأول مؤتمر علمي بحثي يعقد بهذه الطريقة في المنطقة العربية إن هذا المؤتمر سيستمر لمدة 4 أيام يخصص اليوم الأول والثاني لمناقشة وتقديم الأوراق البحثية البالغة 110 أوراق بحثية من خلال 7 أفرع مختلفة في حين سيخصص اليومين الثالث والرابع للتطبيقات العملية والتي تضمن تحقيق كافة الأهداف المرجوة من انعقاد هذا المؤتمر العلمي في الختام أود باسمي ونيابة عن مجلس أمناء الجامعة الموقرين أن أتقدم بجزيل الشكر والامتنان لفريق عمل الذي أشرف على هذا المؤتمر تحت قيادة سعادة الأخ الأستاذ الدكتور مثنى غني عبد الرازق رئيس الجامعة وفريق عمله لكل ما بذلوه في سبيل إنجاح هذا المؤتمر بالصورة التي تليق باسم دولة الإمارات العربية المتحدة وكافة مؤسساتها وعلى رأسها وزارة التربية والتعليم وكذلك ما يليق باسم جامعتنا التي تسعى إلى تفعيل دورها الاجتماعي ليس على مستوى الدولة فقط وإنما على المستوى الإقليمي والدولي في الوقت نفسه وفقكم الله جميعا مع تمنياتي لكم بدوام التوفيق والنجاح لتحقيق كل الأهداف والغايات التي تساهم في خدمة الإنسانية والبشرية شكرا لكم جميعا على تواجدكم معنا اليوم
شكرا لك دكتور أحمد Now, I would like to call Prof. Muthanna Ghani Abdul Razzaq, President and CEO at the American University in the Emirates AUE.
Thank you, Mais. His Excellency Mirza Sayegh, Director of the Office of His Highness شيخ حمدان بن راشد آل مكتوم, member of the board of trustees, also a chairman on board of trustees of AUE, all members of AUE, respected researchers, all participants. Really, it is my honor to be with you today to present something that really we are in this university. I'm going to not to repeat whatever has been mentioned by His Excellency Mirza Sayed and also the chairman, Dr. Ahmed. I will go from this area to avoid any repetition. I want to talk to you about the journey of this conference. Really, first I would like to thank Mr. Mirza Sayed about his for his support and encouragement to deliver this first virtual research conference in Middle East, and also the chairman of the Board of Trustees. The plan for this conference was to be delivered, I think, if Professor Marwani remind me, I think it in April.
March 23rd to 25th.
And 6th. Okay, sorry, March. Right. But because COVID-19, we decided to postpone this conference. But after that, at the University Council, and because the commitment that we said we should go for it regardless the COVID-19, as His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, he said we're going to close schools and universities, but education will never stop. So for this reason, we decided to go to deliver this conference without postponing it to next year. Because even next year, we don't know what's going to happen, really. So the steering committee of this conference worked very hard, starting communicating again with the researchers to encourage them to submit their papers, communicating with the evaluators to assess those papers. For my knowledge, many papers been submitted in those 8 areas that this conference is going to be discussed. For example, if you can see here, the 8 areas, if you can see the on the screen, we have COVID-19 challenges, entrepreneurship, computer and advanced technology, education, industry, security and global studies, law, integrated media, and design industry. So those 8 areas are going to be discussed within the first 2 days. And the impact of COVID-19 on those areas. Each area has been broken down in different topics. For example, I don't want to go in all of them. Entrepreneurship, we see the measuring business impact on society, digital finance and governance, the strategic and look and the corporate challenges in business, budgeting, smarts, and artificial intelligence in computer as well. If we go to the third slide, you can see in education, there are 3 topics. In security and global studies, we have 2 topics. In law, also another 2 topics. And integrated media, we have social media technology and the design, the smart design. So those 8 areas, we found them, the steering committee is very important to conduct practical research in it. I think, as I'm always emphasizing this point, we should move to the applied research rather than concentrating on theoretical part. We need to benefit our country and neighboring countries. So I encourage all researchers to go for applied research rather than just to deliver certain topics in theory. And then we decided to go not only to discuss and assess and evaluate those papers submitted, research papers submitted to the conference. We said, let us go to deliver workshops to try to reflect those research in practice to see how we can move from theory to practice, how we can benefit our society, our community, our students at the universities, not only our university. So we're going to organize 6 workshops in the 3rd and 4th day in all those areas, and you can see them on this slide. In addition to that, just to give you some information, if Hani, you move to another slide, please. The keynote speaker, okay, in all those areas, you can see we have many keynote speakers in this conference. And yet another one, please. Okay. For example, here we have 110 research papers, presentations with their researchers. They're going to talk. 7 keynote session. We have 6 workshops. We have 20, and this is the first time that 20 experts from the industry, they will participate to tell us what's going on in the market and the industry themselves. And we have participation from 25 countries. And this is really a good achievement at this time. And the tracks, you can see, is the same as we have mentioned at the beginning. Number of papers published, or sorry, accepted by the conference, we have in COVID-19 challenges, 8 papers accepted by the steering committee, entrepreneurship, 29 papers, research papers, computer and bus technology, 18, education industry, 18, security and global studies, 9, law, 13, integrated media, 8, and the design industry, 7. So in total, 110 papers is going to be discussed in the first and the second day of this conference. Okay, regarding the nationality of the researchers who have submitted their papers, you can see that 57 papers received from UAE, and 43 papers accepted from the rest of the world. And here in this diagram, we are showing from all the countries, the 25 countries that they're going to participate in this conference. Also, at the end, I don't want to give a lecture in this area. It is really my great pleasure to welcome you all. I wish you a very successful conference. But I want to mention one thing that His Excellency Mirza Sayed pointed out, and we proposed this, I think, 2 years ago. We need even a government cannot finance the research alone. Private sector should play a big role in this area. And we suggested 2 years ago that it should be a mandate or compulsory that all private sectors to allocate some fund for research to support the research grants. If you go to any country, United States or UK or in Europe, you will see that the research coming from private sector and billions of dollars. Therefore, they are really moving in this area. Technology, development, whatever, does not sustain if there is no excellent research base. So we have to encourage the research in all areas and apply the research to solve the problems. We should stop discussing, we should move to action. So this is what now the government moving to this area. So I hope that all those papers will be benefited. Second point I want to mention to Professor Marwan, he's the Vice President for Research at the University. We should not just when we finish this conference, we should not forget it. It should be the start point for applying those papers, and we should do a follow-up. So next year, we should sit at the first day to assess what we have done from August 8 to next August 8. And we need a committee to try to follow up and assess the implementation of all the recommendations going to be done by this conference. So we should not forget it. Each year we should assess and evaluate. And if there are any challenges, we have to propose the solutions to overcome them and move forward. Otherwise, the conference is not going to achieve its objectives. We need to make improvements. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. I'm sorry to take more time from you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
شكرا لك بروفيسور مثنى غني عبد الرزاق. Now I would like to call Dr. Tawfiq Hoja, General Secretary of the Arab Hospital Federation, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, General Chairperson of Arab Union and Anti-Forgery and Counterfeit Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. بروفيسور توفيق خوجة يشغل الآن أمين عام اتحاد المستشفيات العربية وكذلك نائب رئيس الاتحاد العربي لمكافحة التزوير والتزييف ورئيس مجلس إدارة الجمعية السعودية للوبائيات. فضل دكتور.
شكرا جزيلا. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد للشاكرين، والصلاة والسلام على رسولنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. حقيقة قبل لا أبدأ بكلمتي أود أني أثني على الكلام الذي ذكره معالي البروفيسور مثنى ومعالي الأستاذ مرزا وسعادة اللواء أحمد دكتور أحمد على موضوع تخصيص نسبة معينة من استثمارات القطاع الخاص والقطاع الخاص وربح القطاع الخاص في البحوث، وهذه يعني فكرة أول مرة أسمعها، فكرة ريادية. لذلك قبل أبدأ محاضرتي أتمنى أن توصيات المؤتمر وبالأخص توصية هذه، لأن توصية very crucial very valid at the center of the future of 2030 vision، أعتقد أنه ترسل عن طريقهم إلى المعالي الأمين عام لمجلس التعاون لمحاولة إصدار قرار من قائد دول مجلس التعاون حفظهم الله وأيدهم ونصره وتوفيقه إصدار قرار زي ما حصل في الفات، هي ضريبة مضافة إلى رفع التسعيرة على أو الضريبة على المحلات على المشروبات المحلات على التدخين الأخري. فهذه لو تخصص جزء من الفات أو جزء من استثمارات القطاع الخاص 1% as you said على الاستثمار في البحوث والبحوث التطبيقية والبحوث التي تعود بالنفع على الأمة الخليجية بحول تعالى، أعتقد هذه قد تكون من أفضل التوصيات التي أسمعها في حياتي كإنسان باحث وإنسان يعمل في المجال البحثي. فشكرا لك معالي البروفيسور وشكرا للأستاذ مرزا والدكتور أحمد على هذا الطرح المتميز الإبداعي، يعني يلتقي مع مفهوم المؤتمر والنوفيشن الإبداع والبحث عن فرص التحسين سمارت أوبورتيونيتيز. فشكرا لكم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول محمد آل سمعين. حقيقة يسعدني أن أكون معكم اليوم وأدعو الله سبحانه وتعالى لكم بزيد التوفيق. وحقيقة it gives me a great pleasure on this blessed day to welcome you in Dubai City and to this your second beloved country, the United Arab Emirates, to all guests who are participating in this conference. And it's my honor at the beginning of my talk to address the most supreme feelings of pride and meanings of sincere and blessed greetings to His Highness Sheikh Hamdan Al Maktoum, Debitor of Dubai and Finance Minister of Finance, for holding this conference under his patronage. Also, the continuous support from his good selves for scientific activities, especially innovation and looking for smart opportunities. Also, my sincere thanks and appreciation to His Excellency Mr. Mirza, my Major Dr. Ahmed, and Professor Muthanna, Professor Asim, Professor Marwan, Professor Asma, and your good selves, Amber, to everyone and to all official people who are participating in this conference, and respected excellencies, distinguished guests, and sister brothers and speakers. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is the GCC map, the great country, the beloved country. As you know, the GCC country states witnessing a lot of changes in the last few years, particularly in the peculiar of health profile, where there is a movement from infectious disease to non-communicable diseases like diabetes, hypertension, obesity, and bronchial asthma and mental illnesses, and escalating of the cost which facing the financing of the healthcare system. Also, there is a great need for health sector reform in order to accommodate the new movement in healthcare system. Another thing that is a pressure for that we should engage the consumer and the community, as well as we have problems regarding leadership, capacity building, and developing the leaders in healthcare, especially the first line of leaders and the second line of leaders, in order to accumulate the issues of public health and the issues of innovation, and also issue of good quality of care and maintaining safety. Also, there is a problem we are facing in the GCC that you increase utilization of medical technology and the pressure of this medical technology in the management of patients and consumers. Another big issue, as you know, that we are heavily dependent on expatriate, and this is need to how can we enhance the nationals to be enrolled in healthcare sector as a respected sector for future career. And the issue is innovation, and the whole conference is about smart opportunities and innovation, and this is becoming an issue in the GC, especially in the Vision 2030. And it was very clear from the address said by the two eminent speakers in the beginning. The new healthcare facility, what we are facing, it is another challenges that the movement towards what is called person-centered care, people-centered care, patient-centered care. And these concepts are new concepts. We should move from disease-oriented care to a person, the whole approach to the person, and the whole approach to the community and the people. And it's now not anymore, we are pressure, there are a lot of pressure to have the maximum utilization of resources and to have more productivity. Another issue which is facing the new facility, that how they can manage for disaster and emergencies. And as you see COVID-19 is pressurizing on the healthcare infrastructure and the healthcare workforce. So what is the role of the new healthcare facility in this area and also the old one? Another issue that there is, we should maintain the accessibility at the same time, maintain the good quality of care and maintaining safety. And there are other society needs, and it's not anymore that the hospital is run between the boundaries, between the walls. It is becoming the hospital behind the boundaries, behind the walls. It should have a big role in the society. And one of them is research, as you said earlier in this morning. And the existing healthcare facilities, if it is not going to update their level and looking for the new innovative thinking and looking for a new smart opportunities, it will be outdated and it will be out of the market. Another issue that there is with the old or the existing healthcare facilities, there is a problem of maintaining the maintenance of the activities, and at the same time, how can make it more accessible to the people in the issue of a green hospital, in the issue of hospital friendly people. And if you look to the GCC population growth rate, it is one of the highest in the world, and almost double the normal in the developed countries, as well as it is a young society. So most of the GCC, around 40% of the GCC population, they are around under 14 years old. And these people, this group of people, need a special way of care. And also they need more what's called promotive and preventive care, at the same time, wellness approach rather than curative approach, because they are still young and they are still healthy, and they need something to maintain their good quality of life and to protect them from any diseases. But to all of this, the GCC, the governments in the GCC, thank to all of them, the excellent leader we have in our GCC state, they reach a very good health indicators. And our indicators, as said by the WHO, is the best indicators. It is reaching also the developed countries indicator for healthcare. But we are facing a lot of difficulties. We are facing a lot of challenges. And to addressing these challenges, we are looking for smart opportunities, and we are looking for innovative thinking and producing good initiatives in improving the quality and the safety of healthcare in the GCC. Why we have increased the demand for health in the GCC? Because our population is growing very rapid, and also raising the life expectancy in the 50s and 60s. Our age, life expectancy around 50, less than 60. Now we are reaching around 75, 74 for men, 76, 78 for women, and the vision is around 80. So this is the life expectancy has a pressurized on the healthcare, and all with all of this, we have unhealthy lifestyle, which lead to cancer, lead to diabetes and cardiovascular disease. This is another issue, that the expectation of our population is far beyond our imagination. Our consumer, our people, beloved people in the GCC, their expectation, they need Harvard, they need the Mayo Clinic, they need high quality of care, and the same, they need the most sophisticated care in the world. So this has a pressure on the demand on healthcare and need to increase the expenditure on healthcare. As you know, the GCC government cover almost 75% of the total health expenditure in the Emirates region. Emirates region is 22 countries. So imagine 6 countries, they cover all 75% of the total budget. So this is a huge amount of money is given, and it's around 3 to 5% of the GDP. And also with the most of the GCC are now in the health insurance, and this health insurance lead to increase the expenditure on healthcare. Another issue researcher said that within the 10 years, our health expenditure will be raised more than 400%. So imagine, and it will reach $60 billion in the 10 years. So this is really a challenge for our decision maker, how they can maintain financing their care, and what are the options they have to ensure that the sustainability and accessibility, the affordability of healthcare to all GCC countries. If you see the studies done by WHO, EMRO, East Mediterranean region, that to the older 22 countries, that we have problem in achieving the universal health coverage. As you see, the GCC, they achieve this one. But if you look to the all other Arab countries and other countries like Pakistan, Iran, which are part of the EMRO countries, they are facing problems in financing. They are facing problems in what is the strategic movement for vision for healthcare, as well as lack of coordination with all other sectors. For example, in Saudi Arabia, we have around 20 healthcare providers. How they can communicate? So they have what's called Majlis al-Sahha al-Saudi. in United Arab Emirates, they have a higher authority for this one, and so on and so forth. In the GCC, everything is organized, but other countries, they are not the same what we have in the GCC, and this lead to fragmentation of healthcare financing, fragmentation of healthcare provision, and also the patients, they are in they are moving from one sector to another sector. So this is wastage of resources. So this is a big challenge, really. And how can we protect our society from malpractice and from medication error and unsafe behavior? Another issue which is coming so much pressurizing on the GCC, that the using of technology. And this need really, if you see in United Arab Emirates, Saudi Arabia, Oman, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait, and we are moving towards telemedicine, we are moving towards technology, teleconsultation, and so on and so forth. And these need to have a better purchaser, better user. We need to upgrade our skills and expertise in this area. We need to maintain the quality and efficiency and the effectiveness of such utilization of technology. And also, we need to have room of expertise people in order to face any future problems facing utilization of technology. And also, we need to maintain the proper medical care. Doctor-patient relationship, healthcare-patient relationship, and so on and so forth. You cannot depend so totally in technology and forget the contact and the encounter between the consumer and the medical care, medical health staff. This is very important to be addressed. As I said in the beginning, that we are depending a lot on non-nationalists in the GCC, and Saudi Arabia and Arab Emirates, they are the highest dependence on foreign staff in the health sector. And this as a burden, it is a good, and it's accelerated the modernization and also accelerated our expertise and improve our quality of care. But this lead has implication, has an impact on the healthcare system. For example, the high attribution rate, also the people who are qualified and become oriented with the system in the GCC, after a while they move to Canada, they move to UK, to USA, and so on and so forth. So GCC become a place for people they trained and become very well trained, and they move especially the nurses. So this is very important that we need to have a program in the GCC for nationalization of healthcare in the GCC. Another important part now and becoming a voice for every speech in any conference in medical or in healthcare, which is the people voice. And this we are not used in the past. I mean, if you speak with me 15 years ago, 20 years ago about consumer-driven healthcare, I said, what do you mean? People voice in healthcare. So this is new concepts coming up, pressurizing that, listen, you are not the people who are the Minister of Health, the only one who decide on the type of healthcare and the style of the healthcare. We are, as the people, we need to be engaged, and we need to be part of the whole process. And this lead that the concept which is called whole community approach, whole government approach is coming up to address the consumer-driven healthcare and the people voice in healthcare. Because people who are working in the Ministry of Health, even they are the people in that country, but they don't have the real feeling of the patients who are suffering from the disease, as Professor Muthan earlier said about the patient who has cancer. So when you bring the person who has cancer or diabetes in front of you and discuss his real feeling or her real feelings, what she wants from the healthcare, it differ a lot from what the people at the planning area in the Ministry of Health or healthcare facility thinking about the future of healthcare. So this is really a big issue. Another issue is the engagement of the private sector. As you see, in that all GCC all GCC states, there is a huge investment in the role of the private sector as a partner in the infrastructure, patient care. But most of this involvement of the private sector in the healthcare is going to, if you see the scene right now, it is going to the treatment, diagnosis and treatment. And this is has a great impact on the overall investment in the country. We, as from this conference, we would like, as you mentioned in the beginning, to their role in training, in health education, in educating the healthcare professionals, in investment in the research, in community-based efforts, like your beloved and respected university. They have a lot of effort in cancer campaign, and this is a community-based effort. Even you are a university, but you are a part. You are doing your social responsibility in a clear way. So now the private sector has to have effective relationship management with the private and public, and they have to be engaged in areas of research, development, human resources capacity building, and so on and so forth. our government, they are spent almost 70% of the total on healthcare is from our government, but still we the private sector play a major role, and the analysis and researcher, they said that the private sector in the GCC will be tripled in the 10 years coming to 10 years, and the expenses will be raising up. So how can we maintain such raising up of cost with the involvement of the private sector? And another issue, how can in the GCC change the role of the private sector healthcare facility from the situation right now to be part in the total what is called a developmental agenda of the country in healthcare? And this is need that the investor in the hospital and the healthcare centers to think, to understand what is our vision in the 2030, and how can be part in the public health and in the good quality of life rather than in the treatment and diagnosis only. And this is a big challenge, actually, to change from a profit-oriented organization to a community responsible people. So it is different. Sorry. There is the sound. We should to distinguish from public-private partnership and privatization. And the only person or the only way to make it a public-private partnership for the benefit of our beloved people is that the role of the government to put the rules and setting the regulation in order to ensure that the public-private partnership is in real action. And this is my recommendation in the role of the private sector in this area. And it is, as I said in the beginning, that they need to be involved in technology and they need to be in research in area where we need them also in rehabilitation, in preventive approach, in promotive approach, and also they need to be involved in the to improve the primary health care. I mean, it is not only to invest in hospital care, but also in the primary health care agenda. And the primary health care agenda should be addressed very well through the private sector again.
Professor Tawfiq, if you allow me, I'm sorry, Ms. Mays, we have only 5 minutes for your talk to go online with the timer, please. So give us the opportunity to ask you a question as well. So if you can conclude, I'll be grateful. Sorry, Ms. Mays.
Okay, thank you. But they told me 30 minutes only. I finished 20 minutes anyhow. Thank you. So another issue.
Hopefully for this talk, question and discussion, if possible. If you give us the opportunity. I'm sorry for interrupting, but we need to enjoy the talk as well with the questions.
Thank you. So I will leave my presentation to our audience. Please send it them. So I will go jump quickly on my slide. Another issue which is pressurizing on healthcare, and we address it so much in the health, in the ministry, in the council of GCC for health ministers, is the patient safety. And this is an issue really need so many effort, because it is time now that our healthcare should promote the health of the nation on patient safety. And I know that our late Minister of Interior, His Royal Highness Prince Naif, addressed this one as a health security, because without addressing the patient safety, we are losing a lot of resources. So I will move. Another very pressurizing challenges in the GC is the non-communicable diseases, as I mentioned. So we are really in a way that we are the highest in the region for in the world in diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and it was addressed as 60% of the premature death is due to NCDs, which is the non-communicable disease, and it is costs around 50% of the burden of disease. So if you see that diabetes alone, it costs around one third of the in some countries one fourth or one third of the total budget for the health minister ministry. So this is why, because we have aging, as I mentioned before, urbanization, improper healthy lifestyle, overweight, and obesity, and this lead to our health policymaker, they cannot compete with, they cannot cooperate, adapt with this new change in the epidemiological pattern in the GCC, and this need a new actions. And this is seen in so many studies. Imagine that diabetes in the GCC, one in five person, hypertension, one in four, smoking, one in three, obesity, one in two, dyslipidemia, hypercholesterolemia is one in two, and so on and so forth. So we have a lot of things we need to do as a challenges. And this is put our healthcare system under fire. And this is need to be addressed as and the GCC, they are doing a lot of work in this one, but still we need to have what is it said that moving from radar system to which is the radar system, that not to see the patient when it is an emergency and fix them and discharge them. No, we need to have a continuative care, promotive care, wellness approach in order to and this is again issues, emergency and epidemics and pandemics. This is pressurizing on the and if you listen to the Director General of the WHO, Dr. Tedros, he said the life after COVID is not the same before, and a vision for the future, our life will be changed, but we'll survive. But he said that a lot of countries, they are moving in the wrong direction in meeting the emergencies for epidemics. So this is an issue lead that our ministries of health and our healthcare has to have a new way of living, a new way of healthcare management. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Prof. Thank you, Prof. Tawfiq.
So may I have two minutes, please? So we need, what was the solution? Oh, okay, the solution is that, the solution, if you don't mind, that in engaging the people twice, second, that looking ahead, changing the Minister of Illness to Minister of Wellness. This is very important. We need to maintain health, prevent disease, and good health of care. Also, we need to engage in research. We need to engage in the global movement of healthcare, and these are the initiatives. And also, we need to have a proper management plan for the Gulf plan for healthcare, education, and for non-COVID diseases, in order to make sure that our goals is in the right direction. Second or third, that we need that, like your university, to invest in building the capacity of human resources. And this is very important. For example, there are people in technology, people in and senior staff, and there are so many specialties need to be addressed. And university like you, which is very has a good name in the capacity building, should invest in healthcare and produce evidence-based guideline and so on and so forth. So with this, I said I would like to say that we cannot change the past, but we can use it to inform the president to have innovative thinking and look for opportunity for to improve the healthcare in the GCC. With all of this, I would like to thank you, Professor Mutanna, for giving the person to speak about this presentation. It is a huge presentation, and I already published this article in the journal. So I will send it to you if people would like to see to have more depth in this talk. May Allah bless you all. Thank you, and wish you all success in this very excellent conference. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum assalam. Thank you very much, Prof. Tawfiq. I think within less than 15 minutes, our parallel session will start. So you can, all of you, of course, choose your sessions to move on. Dr. Prof. Marwan, I don't think we have time for the question. I don't know if you want to give time for the questions or we if can move on mind, with them.
Don't mind, because the presentation was excellent and very informative. And yes, there is, I think I'm speaking on behalf of Professor Muthanna and the board of trustee. We're going to invite Professor Tawfiq for another day, inshallah, for a long talk. And then we open the discussion and hopefully we have it for a webinar for a couple of hours rather than short. My question to you, and hopefully we open it for the others. Do you trust the World Health Organization, reading the Guardian as supported by Labour, and reading the Telegraph supported by the Conservative, there is a huge conflict with who is giving the world. It's all wrong information. From your side, what do you think? That's one question. Second thing, the medical technology in the Middle East, where are we with that to be helping the medical technology? Where are we with it? Why always we are depending on technology from the West? While everybody agree that we have, in particular, the Gulf countries, they have everything, technology, as Professor Mutanna said, and His Highness Mr. Saiq, as well as Major Ahmed. We have everything. But why we do not trust our system, the health system, or any system for that matter? Why we run always to the West? Either we go to the state, Britain, and so on. What is the problem? That's the final one. Where is the patient voice? We don't have it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Marwan. This is a great three questions. Everyone has a huge answer. But let me start with the WHO. If my colleague allow me, with all respect. The WHO, we trust the WHO as a healthcare provider and decision maker. And the WHO has a big talk in any future movement in healthcare activities and movements. What happens in the last few months, that the WHO didn't have a clear vision on the COVID-19. Why they said it is a new virus, and they don't know the style of this virus and how this virus is doing the pandemic. And I have the same feeling to tell you. I am Professor of Public Health. I cannot accept this statement from the WHO. You are the respected organization. You are the resource for expertise. You are the know-how, knowledge is at you. You have all the facilities, you have all the connection, you have all the collaborative centers in the world. How come you put us in this dilemma? So this is really not accepted from the WHO as a public health specialist. And at the same time, you need to give evidence-based. You are the one who in early 90s putting the guidelines for evidence-based medicine, evidence-based public health. How come you are hesitant and inaccurate giving inaccurate information? And also the voice, the spoken voice for the WHO should be highly qualified and should be do not give any information which both people, especially the scientific people and the lay people, and in a dilemma or in a hassle. So I think you are right, and the WHO understand their mistakes, and they are answering that. They are learning. We are learning. So I don't know. This is a big question. Need really a huge discussion And we need to have person from the WHO to answer, discuss with us valid answer in a very truthful way. The second question, where we are from the technology in the GCC, why we, I think we have people, there is a lot of programs in the GCC in healthcare facilities and ministries, they are developing their own original program. And they are far beyond what is in the WHO and other Western countries. And I remember when I was in the GCC as a Director General of Health Minister Council, we have a GCC committee for health technology, and they produce programs, fantastic programs, and endorse technology as part of the healthcare management. But still, we are not doing a proper what's called إعلامياً to the market. We are not marketing in, as what the other countries do. Now to the people voice. Thank you. This is excellent. Last year in the Arab Health Minister Council in the Cairo, we have a conference called the People Voice, and I think this is not yet very well addressed. So I urge His Excellency Professor Muthanna and the University, American University in the United Arab Emirates, to address this one, because you are going to have the lead, and the same we have in United Arab Emirates so many conference on patient experience. Now it is more than patient experience. We are needing to have conferences on people voice, people engagement. There is a saying that empowerment by engagement. So we empower people, we empower the healthcare sector when we engage the people voice. We should say that this is the healthcare system from the people to the people within the people. Thank you so much, Professor Ramathan, Marwan and Professor Muthanna. May Allah bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you. Over to you, Ms. Mace. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. So at 11:15, our parallel sessions will start. So feel free to join which one, of course, you prefer. Once again, I would like to welcome you all to this exceptional conference. And I wish all participants of this conference that they will find it enriching and meaningful. Shukran lakum jami'an. وهذه كانت نهاية الopening session للconference.
Thank you to you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.